Any kid who's willing to sing with us this morning, if you'll come right over here for me real quick. I'll even take grown adults if you want to come. Anyone else who will come sing with us this morning? We need more than four. Come on. All right. I see a couple more coming. All right. All right. Look at here. Hey, this is what I'm talking about. Look right here. Older teenagers, I like it. Anyone else?
Y'all did good, girl. Did fantastic. I want y'all girls right over here. Hey, girls. Come right here.
Perfect. Good morning. It's good to see each one of you this morning. Everybody doing good? Good to see you. Glad you're here. Let me run over a few announcements that I want to hit right before we get started this morning. If you picked up a bulletin, we ran out this morning. So if you picked up a bulletin, we'll hit a few of these announcements. If you didn't get one, the bulletin is actually on our website. You can get it there, libertypoint.church. If you didn't pick one up this morning. But we do want to continue to encourage and point people to the Camp Cadis forums. If you want to participate in that, or if you even have a project, those forms are available on the bulletin board over here. So please take an opportunity to get those if you're interested in that, as well as our graduates recognition. If you have a graduate that you want to make sure we recognize, please get those to me so that we can make sure we recognize those. And then a new announcement at the bottom of your bulletin, you'll see our VBS dates have been set for July the 12th through the 16th. Looking forward to a great week of Vacation Bible School. And so we're going to need a lot of help to make it happen. So please now mark your calendars and be willing to help us out. And if you have any questions, you can see Bethany for all those. Since I've got a lot of our young people standing up behind me, I want to ask if you're a student, no matter what age, I want to recognize all of our students this morning. So if you're a student here this morning, would you stand up for me just for a second? Man, this is this group that you see standing up front and standing in our congregation this morning. I don't know if you're aware of this, but we've got an awesome group of young people at Liberty Point Baptist Church, and I'm thankful for each one of them. Now, in this group, you'll see athletes, you'll see academics, you'll see people who have a heart for helping out and for service. All across the board, we've got kids who are just good kids. And I wanted to just take time this morning to brag on our students and to just say thank you for taking time out of your day to be here. Thank you, families, for bringing them here, because we are truly blessed. And so thank you so much. You can be seated, but thank you for being here this morning. And with that, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin our services this morning. Father, I thank you so much, Lord, for the picture we just saw in front of us. Got an incredible group of young people standing in our congregation and standing in the front this morning. And so, Father, I thank you so much for each one of these kids, Lord, each one of these students. And God, I pray that you would help us, Lord, to be the kind of church that we need to be, Lord God, to encourage them and to equip them, Lord, to be the servants of you that they can be. God, I thank you for the privilege of being able to see so many of them this morning. And so, God, again, I just pray that you would continue to guide us and direct us. And Lord, as we come to worship you this morning, God, I pray that we would worship you as you truly deserve to be worshiped. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, we've got a treat for you this morning. And if you'll notice, we got Mr. Colton back here on the drums. He's going to play drums for us. So we just got a little medley of songs that we're going to sing for you this morning. Let's all stand now. Victory in Jesus. Gotta enjoy that.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. Precious love. see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you. We sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you.
I'm Vince Frana, and I'm very happy to be a member of Liberty Point Baptist Church. I'm very glad to be providing a testimony here of, well, a discussion with my daughter, Stephanie. Stephanie has had some of her beliefs, I guess, changed in that, yes, she still claims she's an atheist. But get this, on the other hand, she now seems to believe in an afterlife. I can remember a few years ago, and she basically just had the idea that when you die, you just go to the grave and that's it. We had had a marathon conversation of over several hours, in fact, over a lot of issues. She was trying to get me to look at other sources of information for news because she thinks that the sources I use are too much right-wing bias. So at the end of our conversation, she says, I challenge you to look at some other sources of information. Now, I said, okay, fine. I challenge you to look at in the Bible at the claims of Jesus Christ and trusting in him for salvation. So that's kind of where we got to the topic. And if there is indeed life and, you know, salvation and heaven, you have to believe in the Lord. But let's say if I'm wrong, what have I lost? Nothing. But let's say that what if I'm right and you don't believe it? What have you lost? Everything. Not just for life, but for eternity. Well, her response basically, well, I think I'm good enough. God's going to let me into heaven. I told her that's not what the Bible says. That's not what the Bible says at all. Jesus requires that if you want to go to heaven, you have to trust in him. Well, I did say for salvation, to forgive your sins. Although even though she believes that God would let her into heaven, she still says she's an atheist. And I said, God isn't going to let an atheist into heaven. I brought up the fact that when she was a little girl, she claimed to believe. She even told her grandfather, if you don't believe in Jesus, Grandpa, if you don't believe in Jesus, you're going to go to hell. And she was baptized. And she says, oh, I just went through the classes, but I really didn't believe it that much. I had questions that I wanted to ask, but I never really got the chance to ask him. So she just went through the motions. It wasn't long. She was running with the wrong crowd. I guess the discussion pretty much ended that she didn't feel that there was any need to look at the claims of Christ and to trust in him. Stephanie is just, her heart is hard. I have tried to just take advantage of if an opportunity comes up, but I'm afraid that I'm going to have to try harder to create some more of an opportunity. I realize I'm probably going to get some resistance, but if I don't do something, nothing will happen. And I think what I will try to do is bring more of the idea in that in order to be saved, you have to ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins. I didn't really bring that out, and I'm going to have to do that. I hope and pray that, you know, that people will be able to get something that will be helpful to them.
Morning, church. Well, I want to say thank you to Vince for being willing to do that interview for me. And I want to say this. For those of you who say, I can't get up in front of people and give my testimony, getting in front of a video camera is a very easy way to do it, because I'm just standing there asking you questions, and all you have to do is answer them, just like Vince did. And it's really easy, and I can take out all your stuttering, and I can take out all your ums and uhs and all that good stuff, and we can make it as smooth as possible with my limited editing skills to make it to where people understand what you're really getting at. And I just want to thank Vince again for his willingness to do that. Now then, I think he brought up an excellent point in that he said, if he continues to do nothing and just wait for opportunities, nothing is going to change. So I want to challenge you, and when I'm challenging you, remember I got four fingers pointing back at myself. I need to challenge myself to create opportunities for conversation about the gospel. It's not going to just happen. You can't expect a garden to pop up in your backyard. You have to get out there. You have to prepare some soil to make it, give it the right growing conditions before you pop in those plants or before you pop in those seeds. And it's the same way with the gospel. You have to be doing some groundwork. And that happens through your conversations with those that you love so much that you don't want to see them go to hell. So I want to encourage you this week. Keep praying for your one. Please pray for Stephanie. She's my stepsister. I've never physically met her, and she doesn't want to have a conversation with me about the gospel. She has rejected that over and over and again. But please pray and continue to be doing that prayer work for those that you have listed over here, the ones that you love so much. And pray for Stephanie too. Paxton.
Join me as we pray. Father, we come to you this morning, Lord. Lord, with a burden on our hearts. God, after seeing Mr. Vince's testimony, Lord, and hearing his heart for his daughter, Lord, we can't help but pray for Stephanie. God, I pray that you would, Lord, do a work in her heart, Father. Father, that you would draw her to you, but Father, that you would use us, Lord, and those around her and the circumstances, Lord, in her life, Father, to point her to Christ. Father, so that she can ultimately surrender her life, Lord, to all that you have in store for her. God, that she would repent of her sins and turn and trust Jesus, but not just for Stephanie that we pray this. Lord, we pray for those that are on our hearts and minds that we can think of this morning who might be in similar situations. God, I know of individuals on our board this morning, God, who would make similar claims. And so, God, not only for Stephanie and for Brendan, but God, all the others that are there as well. God, we pray, Lord, not because we look down on them, but because we love them, Lord. And God, not only do we love them, but Lord, we know that you do as well. So God, we pray for these who don't know you. And God, we pray that you would use us in some way, God, to point them to Christ in every way possible. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
There we go. All right. Come, now is the time to worship.
Come, now is the time.
42, verses 1 and 2, as the hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee. O God, my soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God as the deer?
Alone.
purify. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold.
Amen, amen. This morning we continue in our series through the book of Micah, so I'll give you a moment as you make your way to Micah chapter 5 this morning. Micah chapter 5. And last week we talked about the power of hope. How if you have a little bit of hope in whatever situation you find yourself in, it encourages you and gives you the ability to be able to endure all sorts of things. If you just have a little bit of hope hanging out in front of you. And last week, that was exactly the message of the Lord through Micah to the people of Israel and the people of Judah. He hung out a little bit of hope in front of them and told them that one day he was gonna make things right, that all things would be the way that he intended for them to be. And so there was that little bit of hope that he hung out. And as we get into Micah chapter 5, man, that hope just grows exponentially. And so this morning we're going to be looking at not just a little hope that's dangling out in front of us, but this morning we're going to talk about hope that can conquer any sort of situation we find ourselves in, a hope that endures and a hope that can overcome. As we begin this morning, I read a story this week from Christianity Today. It was from a really old Christianity Today, and it told the story of George Bush, who at the time was vice president. So Vice President Bush represented the United States at the funeral of former Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev. Bush was deeply moved by Brezhnev's wife, who decided in some sense of silent protest that she would just simply stand by the casket of her late husband and not say a word. And so for the entirety of the visitation, she stood silent beside him. For the entirety of the funeral, she stood silently by the casket up until the point where they're getting ready to close the casket. And right before they closed the casket, Brezhnev's wife shared a gesture of courage, a gesture of hope, and a gesture that would surely rank as one of the most profound acts of civil disobedience ever committed. She reached down and made the sign of the cross on her husband's chest. See, that wouldn't sound like such an act of civil disobedience, but you see, the Soviet countries were secular, completely secular, to the point of being atheist promoting. And so this woman, whose husband was one of the great Soviet leaders, in the citadel of secular and atheistic power, the wife of the man who had run it all, had hoped her husband was wrong. She hoped that somehow, some way, there was another life. She had hoped that that life was best represented by Jesus, who died on the cross, and that that same Jesus might just have mercy on her husband. You see, all of her husband's life was promoting secular values and atheistic values. And there was in her a little bit of hope that there was something more. Hope that he was wrong. If you found your way to Micah chapter 5, we're going to read about a little glimpse of that hope that she had. And maybe this morning we can find some hope as well. Micah chapter 5, we're going to read the first 6 verses. And once you find your place there, I do invite you to stand with me if you're able, as we honor the reading of God's word. Micah chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. It says, "Now muster your troops, O daughter of troops. Siege is laid against us. With a rod they strike the judge of Israel on the cheek. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient of days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of his brothers shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall dwell secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth. And he shall be their peace. When the Assyrian comes into our land and treads in our palaces, when we will rise, when we will raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 princes of men, they shall shepherd the land of Assyria with the sword and the land of Nimrod at its entrances. And he shall deliver us from the Assyrian when he comes into our land and treads within our borders." Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for this opportunity we have to come together and to be in your house. Lord, what a privilege it is to be able to worship you as we've had the privilege of this morning. But God, now to be able to turn to your word. And Father, to talk about the hope that Micah spoke of. Father, a hope that's not far off. God, a hope that we've not placed in something we don't know or don't understand, but God, a hope that has come to us. So God, this morning I pray that you would just be near and dear, and that Father, you would speak to our hearts and we would leave here changed, not because of what we hear in a sermon, but because of what you say to us, Lord. Speak to us today. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. This morning, I think as we look at these first 6 verses of Micah chapter 5, I think we find hope in lots of different situations. And so what I want to do is I want to walk through this passage and talk a little bit about what it says, but what I really want to focus on is the hope that it brings to people in certain situations. And maybe we can apply those situations to our own lives as well. He begins in verse 1. He says, "Now muster your troops, O daughter of troops. Siege is laid against us." Again, let me remind you of the message that Micah has already brought is that judgment is coming, right? Israel and Judah are going to be defeated. That is going to take place. He told them that people would be taken captive and led to Babylon, where they would spend years of their lives. And the thing that they've held most dear was going to be desolate. It was going to be ruined. And so he says here in verse 1, a little bit of a different situation. This time he says, "Muster your troops," because siege is laid against us. He paints this picture that judgment is coming, right? Siege is laid against us. If you're not sure exactly what he's talking about when he's talking about siege here, in battle at these times, a siege would be laid against a city or against a fort. And basically what they would do is they would just surround it, make it where they couldn't get out or go get any supplies, and they'd just wait them out. Like, we'll just stand out here until you give up, basically. And so he says, hey, get the troops together. Siege is here. The enemy is right outside, so to speak. They've come to us, and the enemies have surrounded us. And it says, with a rod, they strike the judge of Israel on the cheek. He says, not only have they surrounded us, but they've already started striking us. The war has come. Get prepared, so to speak. And so what kind of hope do we have in this situation? What kind of hope do we find here? I think we find hope to those who feel like they've been surrounded. Maybe in life circumstances you say, man, I don't feel like I've ever been in a situation where my enemy has surrounded me and I feel like I'm at war. I may not feel like I've been in that situation, but I feel like the walls are closing in on me. Man, I can tell you for sure that there are times in my life where I know maybe you're there right now where it just feels like everything is against you. That's how these people felt. They felt like they were surrounded by their enemy, because guess what? They were. Maybe this morning you come this morning going, man, the circumstances in my life have just, everywhere I turn, it seems like something's going wrong. Everywhere I turn, it seems like I've got problems that I'm having to deal with, and nowhere can I go to escape it. There's hope for those who feel like they have nowhere to turn. Look at what it says in verse 2. He says, but you, O Bethlehem. Bethlehem, this great city of David. Well, we call it the great city of David, but let's be honest. If you do some research about Bethlehem, you find it's not really that great of a city. The only significance that Bethlehem held was that it was the city of David, and the prophecies had told that the Messiah would come from there. That was kind of their claim to fame, right? There wasn't much great about this particular city. Bethlehem was nothing to brag about. I'm from Bethlehem. Oh, wow. No, it was nothing like that. When Chelsea and I moved to Campbellsville, we started doing some browsing. We were going around, not only in Campbellsville, checking out the city, but we started going to different communities around Campbellsville. And one day we ended up in Greensburg, Kentucky. Greensburg has a couple of claims to fame, in case you didn't know. If you're from Greensburg, man, you got a badge of honor that you can put on. Because Greensburg is the home of Ski, the soft drink, not the skis. They're the home, that's where Ski was made. But that's not what caught my attention. What caught my attention about Greensburg was we were walking around downtown Greensburg, metropolitan. You know, we were right in the heart of Greensburg, Kentucky. And I walked past this place that had a hand-painted sign. It was Dumas Walker's. Some of y'all don't understand yet. But Dumas Walker's was right there in downtown Greensburg. And on their hand-painted sign, it had underneath it, made famous by the Kentucky Headhunters. And I was like, we got to go down to Dumas Walker's. Let's all go. So we had to go in there and have a slaw burger fry and a bottle of Ski. And some of y'all are going to have to get on YouTube. Man, we had a bunch of young people. I don't know if y'all noticed how many young people we had. Y'all need to get on YouTube and find the Kentucky Headhunters, Dumas Walkers, and y'all will appreciate it a little bit more after this. But wait till after this. Hold on now. But that's the claim to fame, right? That's the claim to fame for Greensburg. You got Dumas Walkers and you got Ski. Bethlehem didn't have Dumas Walkers or Ski, but they had, hey, we're the city of David, and the Messiah is supposed to come from here. That's all they had. It was not a great place. In fact, it was kind of an eyesore in a lot of ways. But oh, you, Bethlehem, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah. He says, you don't even get a mention in the clans because you're too small. He says, but from you
shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from old, from ancient of days. Therefore, he shall give them up until the time. Hey, do you see what he said? He says, not only is this promise coming for you, O Bethlehem, not only am I going to use you who are too little, who have no recognition from anyone else, who everyone else has counted out and said, you're not worth much. He says, from you shall come forth this ruler. And he's going to do so. He's going to give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of the brothers shall return to the people of Israel. Look at what the hope he brings here. He says, you who feel surrounded, you who feel like everything's closing in, there's hope. You who feel like it's waited too long, there's no hope. We've waited. They're too far gone. He says, he's given them up until the time. There's hope for those who have waited too long. Those who that we've given up on and said, no, man, I don't think there's any hope. They keep talking about so and so is gonna do something in that town. They're gonna get a big factory, and man, that'll turn things around. No, he said that everybody's given up on that. Everybody's given up on the factory coming. Everybody has given up, he says, on the Messiah, the ruler who is to come. Everybody's given up, he says, but he's given them up until the time. Until she who is in labor has given birth. He says that those who are in pain and they feel like it's never going to happen. I know that some of you have been praying for things, praying for family members, praying for those that you care about for a long, long time. And you go, man, I just don't know if it's going to happen. Feel like you've labored over it, literally. You feel like you've been doing this and nothing is happening. He says, but the Lord has a plan for Bethlehem. When everyone else has given up, when everyone else has said, you know what, maybe there's no hope. He says, that's when he who is from of old, from ancient days, he's given them up until that time. And then he begins to bring all the brothers to return to the people of Israel. You see, there's hope for those who feel like everything's closed in. And there's hope for those who feel like everything's stacked against them and it's too far gone. I heard the story of a man who went to the complex, wasn't here, but it was something like our complex, to watch some recreation baseball. He's walking around and he looks at this one game that kind of catches his attention. It's a little league baseball game. And he goes up to a boy who's in the dugout and he says, hey man, what's the score? The little boy responded and he says, 18-0. We're losing. Boy, man, I'll bet that's discouraging. The little boy said, why would I be discouraged? We haven't even gotten up to bat yet. You know, I do think there's a lot of times where we give up on situations long before we should. We got to be reminded that not only maybe we haven't gotten up to bat yet, but I can assure you the Lord hadn't said the final amen on it. Just because someone seems too far gone or a situation seems too far gone or the circumstances seem too big for us to be able to overcome, be reminded that the Lord has the final word. Be reminded that he's the one who has the final say. And when everyone else has given up and when he has given them up until that time, like someone who is in labor that finally gives birth. He says, then I'll begin to bring things together. There's hope for that situation as well. Look at what it says in verse 4. It says, and he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. That verse, I can't help but think that it brings hope to those who don't have strength on their own. That verse says that the Lord shall stand. He's going to be the one that stands and he's going to shepherd the flock, not in the strength of the flock, but in the strength of the Lord. Not only in the strength of the Lord, but in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. The picture here is for those who have no strength, those who feel like they can't go on anymore. Verse 4 says there's hope because the Lord will stand and shepherd them, and he'll use his strength and the majesty of his name. And it says in the last part of verse 4, it says, and they shall dwell secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth. In the final part of that verse, it tells us that there's hope for those who are insecure. Now, a lot of times we don't want to admit that we fall into that category, do we? Nobody wants to admit that they're insecure, right? In fact, we'll cover up our insecurities just so that we don't ever have to deal with it or admit that we're insecure. We'll try to overcome and come across it, even at times as arrogance, to be able to overcome our insecurities that we have ourselves. But this verse says that, hey, even those who are insecure will dwell secure. Not because they know that they're capable of handling things, but because they know who their shepherd is. Because they know who's got them, who's in control, and he shall be great to the ends of the earth. And what a picture of the hope that Jesus brings. Verse 5, we get another hope. We get the hope for those who've not experienced peace. It says that he shall be their peace. When the Assyrians come into our land and treads in our palaces, then we will raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 princes of men. They shall shepherd the land of Israel with the sword and the land of Nimrod at its entrances. And he shall deliver us from the Assyrian when he comes into our land and treads within our borders. What does it mean? It says that he's going to fight our battles. And that those who have experienced a life that doesn't have much peace, it says the Prince of Peace will come. And he'll bring a sense of peace because there's hope that peace will come. Church, as we look at all these different aspects, each verse and sometimes multiple ones per verse, we see that there's hope in all different situations. Hope because of this one who would come. Now we know ultimately that Micah chapter 5 was speaking directly of Jesus. In fact, the prophets in Jesus' day, the Sadducees and the Pharisees, they would even quote Micah. They misquoted in the New Testament, but they would quote Micah to talk about this one who would come from Bethlehem. You see, we know that they were speaking of Jesus. But as Micah was doing this, he'd done so in a situation that seemed so hopeless, church. I don't think we can even begin to comprehend the hopelessness that Micah's audience was feeling at the time. And Micah says, judgment is coming. There's gloom. But he says, don't miss the glory that's coming as well. Don't miss the fact that there is one who will bring a whole new perspective. There's one who will bring hope to different situations. One that will bring hope in the midst of hopelessness. Church, maybe this morning you are in a hopeless situation. Or maybe not hopeless, but maybe you've just lost sight of the hope that you had at one point or another. Maybe you come to this place this morning and you go, man, I could really use some hope in my life. How can we find that hope? Well, that hope is found only in Jesus. He's the one who brings hope regardless of the situation, regardless of the circumstance, regardless of what is taking place. No situation is too far gone. No person is too far gone. His arm is not too short to save. No matter who you are, no matter what's going on, if we turn to the Lord, if we repent of our sins and trust in Christ, he is able, he is willing to save. You see, this hope is for individuals this morning. This hope is for individuals without a doubt. So if you are here and one of those situations fits you, I want to tell you there's hope in Christ. This hope is for individuals. This hope is also for churches. I don't know if you realize that. You see, there's hope for individuals, but there's hope for church this morning as well. You see, old little Bethlehem, the one that everybody had kind of forgotten about. It wasn't a major metropolis. It wasn't a major powerful city of great influence. I'm sure it was a lot like Cadiz, Kentucky in some ways. The people there liked it, some of them. Some of them couldn't wait to get out of it. Some of them were looking for bigger and better things. Some of the people love the city, I guarantee it. A lot like Cadiz, Kentucky. There's hope for a church in little old Cadiz, Kentucky. I heard a pastor who said God chose a stable so that no innkeeper could boast by saying, he chose the comfort of my inn. He said that God chose a manger so that no woodworker could boast He chose the craftsmanship of my bed. He chose Bethlehem so that no one could boast. The greatness of our city made us the divine choice. And He chose you and me freely and unconditionally to stop the mouths of all human boasting. That's the point that we find in Micah 5. That God has chosen to use us. God has chosen to offer salvation to us. Not because there's anything special about you or me. Not because there's anything great about us as individuals, nor is there anything great about us as a church. But God just simply chooses to use people for His glory and His glory alone. Church, I don't know about you, but my prayer has been here lately. Lord, I know you can do whatever you want to. And God, I know that you have the ability to do great and wonderful things. But God, I just pray that you would do it here. God, I pray that you would change hearts and lives in the midst of our people. God, I pray that you would do this for individuals right here. People that we know and people that we care about. People that we've been praying for. God, I pray that you would do it here. And God, I know that you can use any church, anywhere, to do anything that you want. God, I pray that you would use us. God, not for us, and not because we're anything special. In fact, quite the opposite. God, I pray that you would use us because we're feeble and we're weak. God, even if we're honest, we're not capable of much. In fact, we will fail if it's left up to us. So God, I pray that you would use us in our weakness and that you would do it for your glory. And there's hope. There's hope for individuals who feel like walls are closing in, feel like everything's against them. There's hope for individuals in every situation and circumstance. And there's hope this morning for churches. There's hope for cities that God could use and do mighty things in their midst. Let's pray together that it would be here and that it would be us. Father, we thank you so much for this morning. God, and we thank you for your word and God, the truth that it holds. And God, this morning we've looked at situations, God, where you bring hope to where it doesn't make sense even. God, to where you bring hope where things have grown hopeless. But Father, help us to be reminded today that you get the last at bat. Father, things aren't over until you say they are. And Father, we know that the promises of your word are that the victory is yours ultimately. And so Father, we rejoice and Father, we get excited about the hope that we have in that fact. Father, of knowing, Lord, that the victory is yours. And so, God, I pray today that you would help those who feel hopeless to find a hope that's found only in Christ. God, I pray for our church this morning that we might find a hope, God, not in how great we could be, but in, Father, how great you are. And that, Father, we would beg you to move in our midst. God, whatever decisions need to be made, God, maybe some just need to come and pray. Lord, whatever is on our hearts and minds this morning, God, we just pray that you would use this time for your glory. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us this morning?
Bless me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my heart. Hear my humble cry.
For a moment this morning. You know, I do pray that you have some hope this morning. And maybe the hope is something that you need to talk about a little more and find out a little bit more about. And I would encourage you, I would beg you, whatever the situation is, whatever's going on. You might say, Pastor, man, I'm a believer. I've got a relationship with Jesus. I know I'm supposed to have hope during this time, But man, I just don't have it right now. I would love to sit down and just pray with you and pray that God would show how he's very present in every situation. So maybe if that's you this morning, I would encourage you and beg of you, please don't leave here hopeless. Regardless of what's going on in your life, regardless of what's taking place, I want you to be able to have some hope that you can hold on to this morning. Hear that before you hear anything else. I'm also excited this morning. Steve, if you don't mind to come and join me. Miss Linda, you come and join him as well. Steve Heath and Miss Linda are coming forward this morning. Brother Steve is coming desiring to join our church family here at Liberty Point Baptist Church. So if you're excited about that, would you say amen? Amen. We're certainly glad to have him as part of our church family. We've sat down and had multiple conversations about what it means to be a not only a follower of Christ but a church member. So I certainly am excited to have him and Miss Linda come forward this morning. Of course, Miss Linda's been a long time member, but we're certainly thankful to have you, Steve. And so in a moment, as we dismiss, give you an opportunity just to come and encourage him. Also, the Steely family, if you guys wouldn't mind to come and join me over here as well, John and Amy. And Addie Mae, and Averett and Amelia. I was praying for them, and I just said Addie, and Amelia said Addie Mae. So I had to get it right. Did I get it right, Amelia? Did I get it right? Thumbs up. All right, good deal. And so we are so thankful to have them. If you've had an opportunity to get to know John and Amy, you love them already. And so this morning they also desire to come and move their membership here to Liberty Point Baptist Church and make it official, as they said. So if you're excited about that, would you say amen? Amen. Amen. And so again, I want to encourage you to come by and whatever way you feel comfortable with. Man, this is so weird, isn't it? Whatever way you feel comfortable with, to come by and tell them you're so thankful to have them as part of our family. Tell them tell all these folks this morning, welcome home. So again, I'm so thankful that you're here. And as we close in prayer, again, make sure that you come by and welcome these folks as we dismiss this morning. Would you pray with me? Father, we're thankful, Lord, just for your goodness and for your grace. And God, this morning, I'm so thankful for these individuals who are standing here, Lord, desiring to become a part of Liberty Point. And God, we know that it's not because we're anything special, Lord. We've already admitted that. But Father, I do believe that you have something special in store for this group of folks. And so, God, I pray that you would use us, Lord, for your glory, and use us today. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.